We're thankful for those who join us on live stream also. And for even for those of our number who are not able to be here, we miss you and pray that all is well with you tonight also. Tonight we're going to be in the fifth chapter of Luke. This will be our 18th exposition of this book. We're going to be in verses 12 through 26. This, of course, will be an overview of those verses. At this point, Peter and Andrew and James and John have followed Christ, left everything following Christ. And it came to pass when he was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And he put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will. Be thou clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him. And he charged him to tell no man, but go and show thyself to the priest and offer for thy cleansing according to as Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. But so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities. And he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. And it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town in Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed, a man which was taken with palsy. And they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went up upon the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said unto him, Man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, What reason ye in your hearts? Whether it is easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go into thine house. And immediately he rose up before them and took that whereon he lay and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed. And they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today. God, give us to see more strange things.
Yes.
Now we're seeing a slice, as it were, of Jesus' life in these texts. And you notice the crowds are beginning to mount up. Multitudes. In the East, multitude is not like multitude in Joplin. You know, it's a different thing all entirely.
Yeah.
It's a lot. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are coming to hear, not to see, to hear Jesus and to be healed by him. Now, it's difficult to get a lot of people affected by the same thing. This is very difficult. There are people that try to make a science out of this, try and figure out how to get a lot of people together in one place at one time. Mm-hmm. But nobody was doing, the Holy Spirit was doing this here. But there have been times in history where a whole lot of people were thinking the same way and did the same thing. It was very rare, but it did happen. There was a time of Moses, this would have been around 1461 B.C., when the people all got together and gathered an offering for the tabernacle. There's a lot of them. They were all together, perfect harmony. Everybody gave what they could. Everybody did what they could. Quite a phenomenal thing. Now, 400 years later, during the time of David, the same thing happened, except they took up a collection for the temple. A lot of people doing the same thing at the same time. Now, about 300 years passed. I'm showing how rare this sort of thing is. During the time of Hezekiah, a tremendous revival took place, and everybody was out of seeking the Lord. Then a couple hundred years later, in the time of Ezra, the people were stirred up to go and rebuild the temple. There's a lot of people. They all worked together. About 100 years after that, Nehemiah's time, the people all had a mind to work. They all came together, built this tremendous wall all the way around Jerusalem, finished it in 50-some days. Little groups had charge of a section of the wall. All had to fit together. But the people, it said, had a mind to work.
Yeah. Amen.
All right, now the time of Jesus here, if I'm not sure exactly how many years, but it had been a long time. It could be as high as almost 1,000 years when anything significant had rallied the people together. The people were all living in the same city, but they weren't together. There was the Pharisees, there was the Sadducees, there were the Essenes, there were the Zealots, there were Herodians, there was all kind of people divided. They weren't all together.
Yeah.
And here all of a sudden John the Baptist turns up and all the people, they begin flocking out to this without any kind of advertisement. And he's in the desert. He's not like down at the Memorial Hall. Mm-hmm. He's in a desert. They all went out there. Now, then Jesus comes, the same thing. If people are flocking out to see him. And then it's not going to be very long after this, about 50 days, a little over 50 days after Jesus dies, there's going to be another tremendous outbreak of revival and renewal in Jerusalem. And multitudes, thousands of people are going to be added to the Lord.
Yeah.
See, it shouldn't be hard for us to believe that the earth can be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be hard for us to believe this, because there's been times in history when, contrary to the trends at that time, people just gathered together, were together, and all worked together and rejoiced together.
Yeah.
I'm anxious for times like this.
Yeah.
Some people want to see small groups. They like that's a kind of a sign of advance when they can have small groups. See, but I like large groups, large living groups. Maybe I ought to be particular.
Yeah.
Now, our text says that it came to pass when he was in a certain city. Now, I've commented on this. It came to pass. I want to say something else about it again. That this is God's calendar language. This isn't like saying, ho hum, ho hum, and now this happened. You know, that's not the way it is.
Yeah.
We know this is true because Jesus told us he always did what the Father told him to do. So he was operating by a heavenly agenda all the time, whether he was doing something or saying something. Here's what he said: I have greater witness than that of John, for the works which the Father gave me to finish, the same works I do, bear witness of me that the Father sent me. So he's doing the works God sent him to do.
Yeah.
So this, it came to pass, is tied in with that, see?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It was time for him now to be where he is now, and time for him to do what he's going to do now, time for him to say what he's going to say now. He's operating by a divine agenda. These were the works Jesus did among men. And here's what he said about his works. He said, if I do not the works of my Father, believe me not. Don't pay any attention to what I'm saying. If I'm not doing what God said he was going to do
yeah, that's right.
when the Messiah came. If I'm not doing that,
yeah.
don't pay attention to me. Mm-hmm. See, Christians should look at their neighbors over and say, look, mm-hmm. if I'm not the kind of person God said he'd make in Jesus, don't listen to me. Mm-hmm. Don't pay attention to me. Discount what I say, which I do. I mean, I do that. If someone is talking about Christ, some people, it's like blah, blah. You know, uh-huh. they really are, they, because their life tells me, Jesus isn't in these people.
Yeah, yeah.
So you don't listen to them. It doesn't make any difference if it sounds good or not. You don't listen to them. That's what Jesus was telling the people. Uh-huh. Why did he say it? Because he was doing what God told him to do. He says, "If believe me not, if I'm not doing what the Father said the Messiah was going to do, uh-huh. don't believe me, but if I do, if I'm doing what God said he was going to do, if I'm a haven of rest,
yeah.
and I have charge over a thing, and I can make things happen with my word. See, and if I'm this kind of person, believe the works.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
Yeah, that's kind of funny. You got to kind of mull that over in your mind. Believe the works.
Yeah.
The works were saying something.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So when you read in the Gospels, you're reading, those works are telling you something. Mm-hmm. They're bearing a testimony to something. Believe the works mm-hmm. that ye may know and believe that I, the Father's in me and I in the Father. So you see, a lot of people do not even know what Jesus did.
Yeah.
They don't know Jesus' works. Mm-hmm. See, because you can't capitalize on Jesus' works. Mm-hmm. You can't build an institution on Jesus' works. You got to build it on something else. But see, with the works of Jesus, they are vital. They're vital because
yes.
he was doing the works God sent him to do.
Amen.
Now, I understand the works. He said, believe the works. I understand the works to include what was done, where it was done, mm-hmm. and how it was done. I concluded all of those are involved in doing the works. You're in a certain city. And his record of this event, Mark points out it occurred in Galilee where he was preaching in the synagogues. Matthew records it took place after he delivered the Sermon on the Mount. They also said it was, we learned from Scripture, as I'll point out later, it was in Capernaum that this happened. This is the first record of Jesus confronting a leper. Mm-hmm. A man full of leprosy. So wouldn't you know it? It wasn't a fellow that just had a little attack of leprosy in his foot. You know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See, a man would think, oh, if I face a leper, I hope it's just maybe got a little bit of leprosy. I can work with that. But this is full of leprosy.
Yeah.
Full of leprosy. Covered with leprosy.
Uh-huh.
All over. Leprosy is a skin disease.
Mm-hmm.
He was completely covered, his skin, with this disease. It was an advanced case of leprosy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the law spoke specifically about what to do about this kind of disease,
right.
Leprosy. Leprosy is a type of sin.
Mm-hmm.
You can't, like, have a little sin.
Mm.
If you don't get rid of sin, no matter how small it is, doesn't make any difference how small it is. It can be like a little spot on you, like a little spot of leprosy.
That's right.
But if you don't get rid of that, get forgiveness for it, be cleansed from it, it'll consume you and send you to hell eventually.
Amen.
That's how serious sin is. It's like leprosy. Just like leprosy. If leprosy was confirmed, you had to go to the priest, and he knew what leprosy, the signs of what leprosy was.
Mm-hmm.
See, God taught Moses, here's how you can tell it's leprosy.
Mm-hmm.
And so the priest said, pay heed to it. This is really leprosy. So here's, then you'd have what they were to do because of it.
Mm-hmm.
The law directed a leper how he was to conduct himself in society.
Mm-hmm.
Moses said, take heed in the plague of leprosy that thou observe diligently, and do according to all the priests to the Levites shall teach you. Don't treat leprosy by that some code of Egyptian medicine. Take careful heed to this. And Moses said that just before they entered into the promised land. He told about this leprosy. You make sure you do what Moses said to do if you have leprosy. The expression full of leprosy is described in the law this way. If a leprosy break out abroad in the skin, and the leprosy cover all the skin of him that hath the leprosy, from the head even to the foot. See, so that's full of leprosy. Condition is said to have been opposite of raw flesh, or new flesh, fresh flesh, because in leprosy the flesh rots. Finally falls off the bone. Now, as in India, I saw a lot of lepers. I became a close friend of one leper. But part of his face, it was just gone. Mm-hmm. End of his fingers were gone. End of his feet were gone. Mm-hmm. The flesh dies. Some kind of nerve, I understand. They can't feel things. Mm-hmm. And it's quite a picture of sin. I tell you, it's quite a picture of sin. See, sin dulls you so you don't know what's wrong. And it produces deformities. The a medical explanation of it was, is especially the skin and peripheral nerves are characterized by the formation of nodules and maculae that enlarge and spread, accompanied by loss of sensation, with eventual paralysis, wasting of muscle, and production of deformities. So it's a terrible disease.
Yeah.
It's common in Eastern countries. But this man is full of that kind of disease, and he seeks out Jesus, who see in Jesus, he didn't run away. He see in Jesus, fell on his face and besought or begged.
Forgiven.
Yeah. Yes.
Forgiven. Before you get too far from that, isn't it leprosy also a very contagious disease as well?
Well, yeah, it's not as contagious as people think. They isolate them, but it's not as contagious as some disease. But it is. That's they isolated them because of that. Yes.
Considering that as a type of sin, sin's not doesn't contagious, just remain in
right.
one place.
Mm-hmm. That's
spreads.
Right. Yeah, they isolated them because it was possible a leper could walk among people and it wouldn't affect them, but. They had to be at, it had to be at a distance. They had to cover their mouth and say unclean, unclean. If they were in this society, able to get food or water or something, so that would touch on this subject here.
Yeah.
Actually, people are living in sin to try and stay away from other people.
Yeah.
I mean, they won't do this because they're a leper knows he's got leprosy, but sinners don't know they had sin. But sin disqualifies you from mingling with other people. These are not the kind of people you want to fill the church house with.
That's right. Yeah.
Excuse me, but that'll offend a lot of people. But that's just because they don't know anything. They don't understand.
Yeah.
Every backslider, whoever it is or wherever it was, has been in contact with some sinner.
Yeah, that's right.
Every time. When someone's love begins to cool... I've seen it happen for years. Someone's love begins to cool. They're hobnobbing with some.
Yes.
They have had communication with some sinner somewhere, someone with, quote, leprosy.
Right.
Yeah. So he besought him, fell on his face, begged. Besought means to beg. Was urgent. I don't know that you can expect Jesus to do very much for you until it becomes urgent.
Yeah.
Yes, Jonathan.
In that matter, you just brought up about not bringing such people into the church. I mean, it's one thing if a person's wanting to leave that. That's one thing. But a person who's living in sin in some way is actually promoting it.
Mm-hmm.
And in that sense, it's dangerous because there's like with that, there's like an encouragement for others to partake of that.
Yeah, yeah. This man's an example of what you said, that he came seeking a resolution to the situation, begging Jesus. This is how faith conducts itself. So far as it's concerned, the only question is now is going to be whether Jesus wants to do it or not. That's the only. He's going to tell Lord, he knows the Lord can do it. He knows that. He says, if, saying, Lord, if thou wilt. We'd say, if you want to. He knew Jesus could do anything he wanted to do. I don't know how he knew this, but see, that had come across to him. Some way he just had come across to him. That Jesus could do anything he wanted to do. So now the secret to prayer is to get on something Jesus wants to do.
Amen. Yeah.
That's the secret. So you can't be absorbed with your own assessment. I mean, the situation may be very difficult, so you'll have to, but then you'll have to say, if they're willing.
That's right. Amen.
Yeah, but if you can find something you know all ahead of time, you know already ahead of time that Jesus is willing to do this. Like, forgive me. All right, we know he's willing to do
Amen.
He's willing to do this. Lead me. All right, we know he's willing to do that. If you're willing, if you choose. The leper had this understanding of Jesus, and of course that's the way Jesus is. See, now we're living in a time when the face of Christianity has been distorted. It's been changed. This today, Christianity is not the same as it was 20, 30 years ago. It's different. From stem to stern, it's different. It's not the same. Today, people are being told Jesus wants to do what you want. He's there to help you fulfill your dreams. That's what people are being taught this. Now, you don't believe it. Just listen to Christian television 30 minutes. Well, 3 minutes probably. And someone will say this. God wants you to have the best. God wants you to your dreams to be realized. See, but this is not what this leper comes with. He says, if thou wilt, he appeals to Jesus, said will. The most effective prayer is, of course, an appeal that is in sync with what Jesus wants to do. Yes?
Jesus does want to give us the best, but he defines that. We don't.
He defines it. That's right. Amen. Yes.
Well, I mean, Jesus was known as a healer. So naturally, a person who has ailments is going to be drawn to that because they knew that he was willing to do that. He didn't take enjoyment in people suffering, but for a person who's wanting out of sin, what a good thing to know that Jesus does want to get rid of that.
Yes.
So, yeah, people will come to Jesus if there's a conviction of sin and they know Jesus wants that gone, he will take it away.
Amen.
And that'll draw them.
Yeah.
See, it's important to be confident when you pray.
Yeah.
Now, you can't turn this on like a light switch. You've ever tried to turn it on like a light switch, you find out this doesn't work that way. But we've got a word from God on this.
Yeah.
It's 1 John 5:14. This is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us.
Yes.
And if we know that if he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know we will have the petitions that we desired of him. So see, that's what the word God has spoken on this issue.
Amen.
So we say, are there any prayer requests? It takes a long time now. It takes a long time to be delivered from this syndrome I'm going to mention. Some people takes years and years and years before they're ever delivered from when you hear, are there any prayer requests? They think of, is there a crisis around me? They think this is just the way they think. And if you're casual, you'll default. Is anybody sick? Is anybody decrepit? Now, it's not that that's wrong, understand. But prayer's got to get bigger than your personal crisis.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Amen.
If it does, then your personal crisis should carry more weight when you come.
Yeah.
When you come to him.
Well, again, that's why it's so vital that
those who are ministers for the Lord, they make it known who he is and what he's capable of doing. Otherwise, if a person doesn't know Christ, they won't know what that is.
Like, we know what God thinks about holiness and how he desires people to be holy and godly and manage their lives in the interest of the kingdom of God. And see, there should be a lot of prayer requests about that kind of thing.
Yes.
So he says, I know, if you want to, you can make me clean. See, so he talks in terms of the law. He didn't say, I know if you want to, you can take this leprosy away. But that's not what he says.
Uh-huh.
That's not what he says. Because he knew God said he's unclean. He can't mingle with the people. He's unclean. See?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
If you want to, you can make me clean. The words make me clean come from a single word. You can make me clean. it's a creative process.
Yeah.
You can make me clean. You can remove what makes me unclean. Free me from it. Now, the expression, you can make me clean, emphasizes the means through which something is done rather than the something is done.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you can think in terms of this needs to be done. And there's nothing wrong, particularly wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's how it can be done
that
you've got to have some kind of grasp of that. Doug, what he's asking for is not a natural process.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I know, Jesus, that the body will heal itself if you take the right vitamins and drink the right water. See, this is not the kind of thing it was at all.
That's right.
There wasn't anything that could cause this to happen, but Jesus could cause cleanliness.
Amen.
Jesus can make a person clean, whether it's morally clean or clean from disease. He can make a person clean.
Amen.
Occupation too, where the priests would determine ones to declare whether something was clean or unclean.
That's
and
right.
That was really the case.
That's right.
Whatever the priest said.
Remember that there was a time in Israel when the priest said what was clean was unclean and what was unclean was clean.
Right.
They confused.
Uh-huh.
We'd say confused right and wrong. They confused right and wrong. So people couldn't tell what was right or what was wrong. See? Yes.
People coming to Jesus also shows that they saw him as someone who could do what no one else could do.
Because, that's right.
Yeah, this woman with the issue of blood, she's been to physicians. So her mindset was, no one else can do it, but I know he can, though.
Yes.
And so likewise, when you don't look at Jesus like an ordinary person, you don't come with them with ordinary requests, so to speak, that someone else can do.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you're asking Jesus to do what an aspirin could do, just go down and buy an aspirin.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm serious.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Paul would say, take a little wine for your stomach's sake.
Uh-huh.
Don't be asking God to heal those little tummy diseases you have. That's what he was saying.
Uh-huh.
Yep. Just take a little wine for it. Going to ask Jesus to do something, let it be something that only he can do and that really does need to be done.
Yes.
When my health kind of fell apart, that's about as loose as I could say. I wasn't used to this sort of thing. My health fell apart.
Uh-huh.
But then the Lord said, now you've got to make a decision here.
Uh-huh.
I think I shared this with Brother Aaron. I said, I can take away the infirmity, but then you won't be able to see the things you're seeing now. I said, well, I'll take the infirmity. I'll take the infirmity. I choose the infirmity because I don't want to lose what I'm beginning to see it more largely. See? I was mentioning that what causes the effect is what a believer must fasten on, what makes the thing happen. Now, I'll give you three examples of how this is phrased in Scripture. For by grace are ye saved. See, all right, so it's being saved, that's not the emphasis. The emphasis, by grace,
yeah, that's right,
you're saved. See? Here's another. If ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body. See, what I'm saying is the means is what's underscored, not the result. The means. Here's another. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit. See? So this is what this leper saw, this principle. If you will, you can make me clean. See, the sinful nature, or the flesh, teaches us to look at results without considering the cause. So you got a drunk here, or a druggie. So people are prone to look at what that condition, what had been produced, but they need to consider what caused that. The science said, well, it's your genetic makeup. That's what caused it. See, that's not true.
That's right.
That's not true. I don't care what people say. It's not true. Could you imagine Jesus saying that? Oh, that gathering demoniac has a genetic flaw down there. And we gotta treat this special part of his person. You say, well, it just sounds silly, but it is silly.
Yeah, that's right.
When you're indeed dealing with moral defilement, it may look like it's just a mere outward activity, but it's more than that. More than that. What caused it? A man, therefore, the man phrases his request, he's seeking the cause for being made clean. Not just being made clean, but he knew who to go to about this.
Right.
He didn't go to the Pharisees and the doctors of the law about this.
Right.
He went to Jesus about it. Now, I wanted to say a word about what I call the curse of casualness. Disinterest, half-hearted, detached, unplanned, unconcerned, casual. In the average church setting, if not all, but much of prayer is characterized by casualness. You'll pick up on this if you just pay attention. Ho-hum. You can tell by the level of participation in some religious gatherings. People want looking around during prayer, looking around. Even though Jesus said, shut the door, they leave it wide open. Looking around. Never really inquiring. Was that prayer answered that we prayed last week? See, you don't hear? What about that prayer we've been focused on? Anyone had a report on what has happened?
Yeah.
See?
Uh-huh.
Casualness removes all that, all that kind of stuff.
Uh-huh.
It betrays the very presence of carnal casualness betrays a lack of awareness of deity. Like tonight, Jesus is among us.
Amen.
You may not have a sensation telling you that, but we've met here in his name. If it wasn't for Jesus, we wouldn't be here.
That's right.
And so he's here, but not to be aware of it. If you're not aware of it, you just miss all the benefits, that's all.
Amen.
You'd be like Jesus was in town, but nobody knew he was there. This leper knew he was there. This is a good place to draw close to the Lord and let your request, personal request, be made known and deal with some when you're in this kind of environment.
Yes.
Now, I want you to ponder the record of people that came to Jesus with a need and how none of them were casual about it. There was a nobleman who came about his son at the point of death. He wasn't casual. There was Simon Peter's mother. They told Jesus about it. She had a fever. They went, told Jesus about it. The centurion with a sick servant. Come and he pled with Jesus. Do something about it. Jesus, Jairus and his dying daughter. His daughter was dying. He was focused when he came to Jesus. the woman with an issue of blood, if I could just touch the hem of his garment. See, she wasn't casual about it. Two blind men, oh, have mercy on us, they kept on crying out, thou son of David. Syrophoenician woman followed Jesus, kept saying, I got a daughter that's vexed with the devil. I got a daughter. She kept following Jesus. Jesus ignored her. He ignored her. And the disciples said, well, tell her to go away. She kept on asking. See, if she'd been casual, she'd have said, well, this must not be the time. He must be busy today. He's probably going somewhere else. See? But she pressed in and she got the blessing.
Amen.
There was the blind man of Bethsaida. He took outside the city to heal. The man with the lunatic son, remember him? He said, if I could do anything, have mercy on us, Lord. My son, he's got a demon. The demon makes him jump in fire and water. Mm. Boy tries to drown himself and tries to burn himself up. Help us. Mm. And the 10 lepers that came to Jesus. What I'm emphasizing here, that you'll not find any hint of casualness in people that came to Jesus to resolve some situation that was bothering them and plaguing them. Now, I'm in no position to judge matters like this, and I wouldn't want to. But when you come to Jesus about a matter, whether it's a health matter, family matter, whatever, be ultra serious about it.
Yes.
Because if it's not important to you, believe me when I tell you, it won't be important to him.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
But if it is, if you find it hard to live with this condition, you would like God to have mercy on it, God will listen to you on a more ready matter. If there's a hint of casualness or indifference, you'll probably go away without anything happening. Now, I don't doubt that a lot of prayers aren't answered just for that reason. They're not urgent enough. Now the Holy Spirit then throws this little sentence out, which this is the only place it says the power of the Lord was present to heal them. What a that indicates it wasn't always that way. This tells you that Jesus went where the power was going to be. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. So Jesus knowing that, see, he put forth his hand. Now, this was not the normal thing you did. You didn't touch the leper.
That's right, yeah.
Now, here's what the law said about a leper. Leviticus 13, that whole chapter is about leprosy. The leper in whom the plague of it is, his clothes shall be rent or torn, his head bare or shaved, and he shall put a covering upon his upper lip and shall cry, unclean, unclean. All the days wherein the plague shall be in him, he shall be defiled, he is unclean, he shall dwell alone. Without the camp shall his habitation be. Again, Numbers 5. Now command the children of Israel that they put out of the camp every leper, and everyone that hath an issue, and whosoever is defiled by the dead, both male and female, shall ye put out. Without the camp shall ye put them, that they defile not their camps in the midst thereof, where I dwell. So that's why. It's because God's there.
That's right, yeah.
Yet it is commonly taught that if God's there, bring him in. The leper examined the priest, confirmed it was leprosy, and then pronounced him unclean. Then the law said, don't touch anything unclean.
That's right.
So for Jesus to touch a leper violated the law of Moses.
Yeah, that's right.
But just as Jesus was the Lord of the Sabbath,
Amen.
He was the Lord of the law.
Amen. Yes.
Same way. Mm-hmm.
Remain unclean.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. So Jesus says, I will. That's all he said.
Yeah.
I will, before he made the pronouncement.
Yeah.
Other verses say, I'm willing. Now, if you could hear Jesus, would that not sound good? I'm willing.
Amen.
I do choose. New Revised Standard Version said, it's my pleasure. One version says, I do want to. I want to do this. Living Bible says, of course I will. What a glad sound those words were to that leper. The Lord, with all power, wanted to do what the leper asked. It seemed to me that's something we should earnestly seek. You've got his word on it.
That's right.
Then what does he say? He said, be clean. Be. That's a condition created by a word. Be.
That's right.
Let there be light.
That's right. And amen.
Let the waters above be separate. Be separate. The waters breathe ahead. So see, you can't say be. You you can't say that, but he can. This is involved in all things being possible with the Lord. He can just say, be, and the condition, the condition exists. Thank God. I got to be convinced of that now before I bring things seriously to the Lord. But the gospel is designed to convince you of that. To convince you of that.
Yes.
That with God, all things are possible. The Lord will summon a clean slate. He'll just summon it. Yes, Brother Jason.
You know, under the law, there never was anything about a priest making someone clean.
That's right.
The priests were to, they declared it clean or unclean, but like if you had leprosy, you had to just hope that you got better.
That's right. They couldn't do anything about it.
So when you go back to the priest, he just looks at it again, and if it's healed, then... But the priest didn't make it.
No.
So this is an illustration of there are some things the law of Moses cannot do that Jesus can do. The law never took away leprosy. It could declare you unclean from leprosy, but it could not like take it away.
Amen.
Now Jesus, when he touched him, he transferred his cleanness to him, and the uncleanness never went back to Jesus.
Right.
Same way when he took away our sins, he went into a land not inhabited, and he left the sin behind. It didn't contaminate Jesus' nature.
No. Sister Barb?
Yeah, I've been thinking about the provision of the law, though. There was a provision made that when someone was healed from leprosy, they were to go show themselves to the priest to confirm the healing, to confirm the cleanness.
What I saw in this is
the Lord, long before Christ, made provision for his work to be confirmed.
Amen.
And he'll do this in our own lives. He will long beforehand make provisions so that later on down the line when his work is done, there'll be something to go back and confirm what
he did.
Yeah.
Amen. We're going to spend some time on that very subject, but that's the truth.
Amen.
The condition created by God, confirmed.
Yeah.
And the scripture says the leprosy departed from him immediately. There are times when an immediate answer is the only acceptable answer. Like if you're Peter sinking on the water, you don't want a gradual deliverance. You're Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the furnace. You want the fire right now not to burn you.
That's right. Amen.
So there's sometimes an immediate reaction is necessary. It is true, we can't guarantee immediate answers. We can't make them happen, like the priest couldn't make the leprosy go away. But God can make things immediate.
Amen.
We must not grow accustomed, though, to God working gradually.
Yes.
Took a long time to get in that shape. It's going to take a long time to get out of it. You don't want to get accustomed to thinking that way.
Yeah.
I've had this for a long time. It's going to take a long time to correct it. See, you don't. When you're dealing with God, you don't want to take it that way. The leprosy departed from him. So that tells me it was something more here than just a disease.
Yeah, that's right.
The leprosy departed. I can understand you could maybe take that too far, but I don't think it's taken far enough. Most of the time, the leprosy departed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just an introductory
view of God will lead one to pursue if he doesn't work gradually. I mean, look at creation. Mm-hmm. He didn't work gradually in that.
That's right.
He didn't take his time. So one can easily like just see like the beginning.
Yes.
And include like God's not like a slow working, work pending type God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've never heard anyone really teach that that's how God was, but they insinuated that uh-huh. the way they taught. And Jesus charged them, don't tell anybody. Gave him a command. Tell no man.
Yeah.
Right now, go show yourself to the priest.
Uh-huh.
Jesus, of course, has a right to tell people what to do. Don't tell anybody about that. Throughout history, there have been seasons when the professed church has seemed to disrespect what Jesus said. Until the church obeys Christ, it has no right to tell anybody about Christ. You gotta see this now. God will not support people who live in contradiction of what he said. And we shouldn't expect him to. Tell no man. Now, Jesus didn't always tell people this. He told the Gadarene demoniac, go and tell him what great things I've done to you. So there was one he told him to go and tell. Although he didn't tell the Samaritan woman, don't tell anybody, but she just went out and told him anyway. There are other times when Jesus told people not to divulge what they knew about him. What you've seen, don't tell anybody. Peter just made the good confession, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, but my Father which is in heaven. Mm-hmm. And his next words were, don't tell anybody this. Mm-hmm. Don't tell anybody this. Mm-hmm. Tell no man. That's Matthew 16:20. Matthew 16:16 is where Peter made the good confession. Matthew 16:20 says, he charged his disciples they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's premature at that time. But the more, in our text, the more he charged people not to do this, the more they did it.
Mm-hmm.
And blazed abroad the matter. You remember when Jesus was transfigured with Peter, James, and John?
Mm-hmm.
They saw him transfigured. His inner glory burst out
mm-hmm.
through his skin. They're coming down the mountain, and Jesus says to Peter, James, and John, that they should tell no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. Now, how'd you like to keep that under? How'd you like to keep that quiet?
Yeah.
There were 9 other disciples that weren't there.
Yeah.
Don't tell them what you've seen. When I'm risen from the dead, then you can tell it. When the Lord raised Jairus' daughter, he told her parents, that they should tell no man what was done. Don't tell anyone I raised your daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Now I want to try to make some sense out of this. He didn't, as I say, he didn't always tell people to do that, but he did for these reasons. Jesus did this to prevent premature popularity spreading. Because the more popularity spread, the more it agitated the Pharisees and scribes until finally they determined to kill him. And
mm-hmm.
see, so there was an appointed time. Jesus was to die at an appointed time. So he couldn't get things out of hand before that. So don't keep this down. Keep the spreading of popularity. Not because he didn't want to be popular,
mm-hmm.
because that's what was going to bring in his death.
Mm-hmm.
Second, so that confidence would not be placed in what Jesus had done,
mm-hmm.
but in Jesus himself.
Yeah.
If you talk about what Jesus has done and don't do it properly, pretty soon you're giving glory to what was done rather than the one who did it. wait until the work, and this touches what Sister Barbara said, wait until the work is confirmed. Mm-hmm. Wait until it's been by, and God's representative will assess the situation, and he will tell you, you're clean. This is not a temporary situation. In other words, the new flesh had had grown in, see? And also to bolster the confidence of the man by the testimony of the priest. The priest said it's just to bolster the confidence of the man. Show thyself to the priest to confirm the testimony. If a person thinks they're saved, and they are of the persuasion they're born again, it's good if someone who knows the Lord can confirm it. Yeah, I can see that's the case. I can see that that's the case. See, if you love the brethren, it assumes you've seen that they're brethren. How you don't love the brethren just because they're called brethren. I mean, that's not why. It's confirmed. Show yourself and then offer for the cleansing. It was an elaborate procedure. This is taken from the Jewish canons I listed here. I won't read it. The elaborate procedure, if a person had been cleansed, it was remarkable what they went through, the cleansing procedure. You can read the scriptural account in Leviticus 14. 1 through 57. Is this a lengthy, lengthy confirmation process? It took a lot longer to confirm it than to actually do it. See, confirming your disciple takes a lot longer than becoming a disciple. Confirming it. Remember I said that Paul and Barnabas went around confirming the disciples. Well, that's what confirming meant. They, in other words, when they left, the disciples were assured that they were the Lord's. Let's comment briefly on the role of confirmation. In matters pertaining to the purpose and work of God, assumption and supposition are out of order. God works through the truth itself, not through what men say about the truth. So at some point when what God has said happens when a person is born again, at some point that's got to be seen in the person. Mm-hmm. When it is, that confirms.
Yes, amen.
Confirms the testimony. Just as surely as the law required the priest to confirm the absence of leprosy, so the followers of Christ are to be confirmed and verified.
Yeah.
If Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. Mm-hmm. The body is dead toward God. Mm-hmm. If you're in Christ, you won't be looking to your body for confirmation. The body is dead. Even though it's dedicated to God, it's been purchased by God, and your body's a members of Christ, it's not where the confirmation is. To apply it to a modern practice, there are people who say that the Holy Spirit, when you're baptized by the Holy Spirit, it's confirmed by what your tongue does. Sometimes it's a feeling you have in your body. Oil, like hot oil running from the top of your head down to your foot. God does not confirm his work in your body.
That's right.
That's the one part of you that hasn't been changed yet.
That's right.
It has to be harnessed and marshaled, you see. Confirmation. If the spirit of him that raised up Christ from the dead dwell in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit. This is a New King James Version. King James Version says he'll quicken your mortal bodies. That's not speaking about the resurrection from the dead.
That's right.
The resurrection from the dead is not quickening your mortal body, as you get the new body.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
See? So if you've had trouble serving God and suddenly you find yourself able bring your body into subjection, this is a confirming, something that will confirm that you have the real, real thing. Where godliness is not preferred or exhibited in the body, there isn't any confirmation that the person is what they say they are. We're in no position to exert final judgment. I understand. We're not authorized to make this person go into hell. You know, it's just we're not licensed to do that. And don't make a practice of doing it, because you don't know that to begin with. You don't know that. So you can't. But the person himself can be confirmed. Confirming signs, here's four of them. They that are Christ have crucified the flesh, together with affections and lusts. That's Galatians 5:24. So that now you can take that and examine yourself. Have I crucified the flesh? Have I managed to keep the flesh in subjection, subordinated? We are those who worship God in the Spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. All right? Do you rejoice in Christ Jesus? Do you not have any confidence in the flesh? See, then that confirms that
yes.
You're a real person. And all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. All right, are you suffering persecution? Are people aligned against you because you're in Christ? That's a confirmation
yes.
to you. And not being of the world. Ye are not of the world. I have chosen you out of the world. See, that if you're not of the world, you don't blend in with the world. You don't blend in anymore. That's a confirmation.
Amen.
You've showed yourself, so to speak, to the priest. And
yes.
That means clean. That's what that
yeah.
means. But so much the more went there abroad a fame of him, great multitudes came together to hear.
Yeah.
Now Christ's ministry is underway. John the Baptist has prepared the way for him. They came out to hear John. Now they're coming out to hear Jesus, so much the more.
Mm-hmm.
Here we have, this truth is lived out in this text. A city that's set on a hill cannot be hid.
Mm-hmm.
If you got real life, you can't hide it.
Yeah.
Even men don't light a candle and put a bushel on top
right.
of it. Even men don't do that. Do you think God's going to do it?
No.
Not at all. Here it is, lived out in Christ Jesus. It's wrong for anyone to present Jesus in a manner that does not distinguish him from all other people. If people try to make Jesus kind of like us and he understands your weakness, this is not how Jesus is distinguished from everybody else. He's not like everybody else. Be separate from sinners.
Yes.
Totally separate from sinners. Great multitudes came together to hear. That I couldn't get that out of my mind. I thought about it, dreamed about it, woke up thinking about it. Came together to hear. Large crowds to hear. So I thought, I wonder, Jesus is represented saying a lot. I wonder if anyone's figured out how many words of Jesus are in the Bible. I couldn't find anybody that did. I finally got tired of looking. You think somebody would have, some of these mathematicians would have counted them up. How many words of Jesus? I could count them myself, but I didn't want to. But there was a person who had counted the words of Jesus in the Greek language, which traditionally are fewer words than the English language. And so this is what this man had to say. Matthew has 8,285 words of Jesus. Mark has 3,566, and Luke has 6,177, and John has 6,574. There's 72 in Acts, and the Revelation has 9,000. That's 33,674 words
uh-huh.
of Jesus. That's an approximation, but it's a pretty big approximation.
Yes.
That'd be a fairly good-sized book,
yeah.
you know. 50, 60, 70 pages, something like that, of a readable font.
Mm-hmm.
I point this out because I am more and more impressed with how few people want to know what Jesus has said.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of staggering.
Yeah.
But these people came out.
That's right.
In mass, mm-hmm. to hear what Jesus had to say. They didn't come out to a concert. Mm-hmm. You can get people out, you throw a concert, now you can get a lot of people out.
Yeah.
But have a speech, now, be another story. Now, in my younger days, I recalled about it. But if we would hear that a well-known preacher was in the vicinity, within travelable vicinity, mm-hmm. I'd go and listen. I'd go hear that. I'd go hear. If I could get there, I'd go hear. Mm-hmm. My young years, I mean from 17 and up, mm-hmm. traveled to hear that man. One time, Brother Boyce Moten in 1954, Brother Boyce Moten and I traveled several hundred miles because there was a group of men that we felt knew more than the men we were with.
Mm-hmm.
In Bible college, we travel and we to hear these. And this was common. I mean, this the people I traveled with. This was a common trait.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "So and so speak." We said, "Oh, so and so is a person noted for knowing the things of God." We'd cancel a bunch of stuff to get there to hear him. See, that's the kind of thing that was going on here.
Yeah.
People were anxious to hear what Jesus had to say, profitable words, and they came also to be healed.
Yeah.
See, so they were. They didn't come to see if he could heal.
Yeah.
They came to be healed, and to be healed by him. Now there's a sickness, various sicknesses. I wanted to take a moment to specify that the enormous number of diseases that were known at that time. Now there were general classifications: diseases, vexed with unclean spirits, possessed by demons, infirmities, see, those are broad categories, plagues, all that were disease, all manner of sickness and all manner of disease, diverse diseases, see, the sick, those are general categories. Here's some specific things: fever, leprosy, paralysis, impotence, invalid, withered hand, blind, dumb, issue of blood, hemorrhage, maimed, lame, lunatic seizures, leprosy, spirit of infirmity, bowed over, dropsy, see? And then I give you a category of diseases that were known historically at that time in that part of the world. It's phenomenal. So when it says all manner of ill, all manner of disease, see, this is really saying something.
Yeah.
It just singles out some particularly bad cases, but these diseases were only a faint reflection of the moral and spiritual diseases of the soul.
Yep. Yes.
Yes.
Well, yeah, there's expressions where Jesus said, like, your faith has made you whole.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the fact that he says stuff like that shows you people weren't, like, coming in with their fingers crossed.
That's right.
Yeah.
I mean, they knew that if they could get to him, they'd be healed.
Yeah.
That's because the real Jesus was there.
Yeah.
How many of these people respond, we understand that that varies from time to time. But some people will see it. Take, for instance, the effect of sin upon a person. Now, there's broad categories like sins, iniquities, transgressions, without strength, coming short of the glory of God, alienated, deceived, foolish, in bondage, walked according to the course of the world, children of disobedience, by nature children of the rest. See, those are broad categories of all kind of details are in there. And the healing power of Christ is more applicable to those than it is to the external diseases. See, those were a picture. Sin takes a vast, complex variety of appearances. Jesus can handle them all. Sin creates complexities that are staggering. Jesus can cure them all of them. You can see the effects of complexity on the body teach us what can happen to the soul.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we got this picture. Multitudes are coming. Just multitudes are coming. What are you going to do about that, Jesus? Maybe he builds a tabernacle. Maybe he'll build a coliseum. He withdrew himself.
Yeah. Yeah.
I dedicate this to megachurch builders.
Yeah.
He withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. Now this thought, you've got to join it to the previous thought.
Uh-huh.
Tell no man, they're coming in by droves. Uh-huh. What does Jesus do? He gets up and leaves.
Yeah, that's right.
Goes and isolates himself.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because there's a certain drain that takes place on the human soul, and even on Jesus,
mm-hmm.
when you're around people that are flawed and defective.
Yeah, yeah.
He didn't forsake them altogether. Mm-hmm. Jesus didn't do that. But there come a time he just got up and left and went to the wilderness. And the text is teaching us that this was not something he did one time.
Mm-hmm.
This is something he'd do virtually every time the crowds begin to come. And
yeah.
pretty soon he'd just withdraw and go out to the wilderness and pray to be refurbished and re-strengthened.
Yes.
All right, you have a job.
Mm-hmm.
It's demanding.
Mm-hmm.
I know about that.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes something out of you.
That's right.
Spiritually.
Uh-huh.
Even though you're working under the Lord.
Yep.
You're doing it for him.
Uh-huh.
But you have a certain capacity.
Mm-hmm.
That pretty soon you gotta get built up. I mean, that's all there is to it.
Yep.
That happened to Jesus.
Yes.
It shouldn't surprise you that this happens to you.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And blessed is the person who knows when to get up and leave.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Some people don't know when to, so they stay there till they're just beat down in the mud, you know.
Yeah.
If you have extensive family relationships,
mm-hmm.
you're going to have to know when it's time to go.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, nobody can tell you. You can't dictate to another person in this area, but we want to make each other aware of this situation. Now he leaps. Remember, in the record, he's giving you what God's doing. He's not giving you a daily journal of everything that happened. The Bible's not like a diary. So he leaps forward to the next thing that God's doing. It came to pass on a certain day he was teaching. He was what? He was teaching. You might be surprised how proportionately few Christian people see Jesus as a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Just ask around, you'll see.
Yeah.
People don't think of Jesus as a teacher, but he was. It came to pass one day when he was teaching on a certain day.
Mm-hmm.
That is, this is a scheduled day, because he said the Son can do nothing of himself. It's in that context, certain day. I can of my own self do nothing, as I hear I judge, see,
mm-hmm.
on a certain day. I have a greater witness, the works which the Father hath given me to finish, see. I do nothing of myself, but as the Father taught me. See, he taught people that when I live, I move at the Father's impulse. I speak at the heavenly impulse. This is how I am. So when it says on a certain day, this is what God
mm-hmm.
moved him to do at the time.
Amen.
Now, when he was teaching, this insinuates that pure religion is thinking religion.
Yeah.
It's not a feeling
uh-huh.
religion, although we do have feelings.
Mm-hmm.
We have different feelings. But it's a thinking religion. Now think of some words that capture it. It's a thinking religion. Knowledge,
mm-hmm.
understanding, perceive, comprehend, meditate, thought, cogitations, ponder, muse, consider, discern. See, those are all thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching promotes all of these activities.
That's right.
Spend time with Jesus, you start thinking.
Uh-huh.
You start discerning, comprehending, apprehending, perceiving. See? This is what his teaching produces.
Yeah.
There were Pharisees there. These were very disciplined in external behavior.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have any help groups for Pharisees. They had mastered the art of looking holy.
Yeah. That's right.
Jesus said they were full of dead men's bones, but see, they mastered. They were a very disciplined segment of the Jews. The doctors of the law, they were experts in Scripture. They could tell you what the Scripture said and what its common meaning was, and they could probably correlate it. And if you asked what Scriptures are about the Messiah, they could tell you about it. They were experts at handling the Scripture. Now, there's fewer and fewer doctors of the law in our day. These kind of persons are getting kind of rare. But these people came from all over the area. Now, this had to be somebody that draw these people out. They came out from all the cities in Galilee and from Jerusalem and the whole surrounding area. They flocked out to hear Jesus. Says they were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. That was a wide territory. Give you a little map there. This is, you know, a considerable territory. Mark says of this occasion, and straightway many were gathered together, insomuch there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. You couldn't even get to the door where you kind of look in and see what's going on. And he preached the word unto them. That's what he did. He didn't say, let's split this up. We'll have a meeting later this afternoon. This group come then, that group come some other times. He just told what he did.
Yeah.
You know, then if you wanted to hear Jesus, you had to stay.
Yeah.
And then where it states, the power of the Lord was present to heal them.
Yeah.
Boy, it's the only place in the Bible that phrase is used.
Mm-hmm.
The power of the Lord was present to heal them. The word translated power is dunamis. You probably heard people. This means dynamite. You know, it doesn't mean dynamite. Dynamite's an inappropriate definition of power. Dynamite blows things apart.
Yeah, that's right.
The proper parallel is dynamo.
Uh-huh.
That'd be a proper parallel. A dynamo generates, is productive.
Yeah.
Dynamite is destructive.
Mm-hmm.
See? So the power was there to be productive. This power was productive in healing people. There was a particular kind of power.
Mm-hmm.
Was there? The power of the Lord was present to heal people.
Mm.
And I give some statistics there about the word power. I don't want to spend time there, but Jesus knew this, see. Maybe the people didn't know, but Jesus knew this. The power is here to heal people. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, maybe you already mentioned it, but this would fit with what John said, that when Jesus said, whatever I see my Father doing, that's what I do.
Amen.
So the power of God was there, and you can guarantee Jesus knew that.
Amen. Amen.
A lot of people don't, though.
Mm-hmm.
So when someone's request is in sync with...
Yeah.
So they bring a man there in a bed, helpless man.
Mm-hmm.
Mark says it was four men carried him in. And they sought means, they tried to find a way to get inside the house.
Yeah.
They sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. So they didn't ask someone, hey, go tell Jesus to come out here.
Uh-huh.
They didn't do that. They wanted to get in. They wanted to get where Jesus was, right close by.
Uh-huh.
But they couldn't find a way. Mark writes of this occasion, straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them, and they came to him, bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down a bed wherein the sick of palsy lay. Well, I don't know how far they carried this man.
Uh-huh.
Well, how about that for creativity?
Yeah, that's right.
There was some, we would call them tiles.
Uh-huh.
But the roof was in sections, so they climbed up on top of the roof. And if you've ever been in the East, the roof was an area of activity. It's an area of activity. They climbed up there, and they had to know approximately where Jesus was. And they open up that roof and they let this man right down before Jesus.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, when you're that concerned about getting somebody to Jesus, yeah, I think you could expect something to happen.
Yeah.
That's most remarkable. Sometimes we confront circumstances and say, this isn't the time. This isn't the time. That's what it looked like. See, it looked like this wasn't the time.
Right.
These men, oh, they tried to find a way in. Mm-hmm. Maybe one of them said, hey, let's go up on the roof. We'll overcome this. Mm-hmm. Let them down to the ropes, you know. There's a little picture there, someone kind of figuring out how they did this. This is why you've got to expend holy effort. If you want something from God, you have to expend holy effort.
Yes, amen.
In a sense, you have to be creative. You'd be surprised what you can get done.
Yes.
In a short period of time, if you put your heart and mind to it.
That's right.
They couldn't find a way, so they went up on the rooftop. Well, to be perfectly honest, that's always the way. If you want an answer, you do have to always, you have to go up.
Yeah.
You can't go down.
Mm-hmm.
You got to go up. So if you can't find a way, you're trying. Now, you must know what I'm talking about here, but there's sometimes you're trying to find how to get this situation, whatever it's concerning, you're trying to find a way for that thing to be resolved. And there's a crowd around the door. You can't even, like, see what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You can't let that discourage you.
Yeah.
You got to keep looking for a way.
Mm-hmm.
You may have to go up and do a little hefty work first.
Yes.
Lifting the tiles up.
Mm-hmm.
Find out where Jesus is located, because you don't want to let him down at this side of the room and find out Jesus is over the other side of the room. You want to let him right down to the right place, which is what you want to do. Listen, if you're bringing your loved ones or friends or somebody to Jesus, you want to make sure they get to Jesus, not just in the general proximity.
Yes,
they didn't like leave the guy laying out in the front yard,
mm-hmm,
hoping that, you know, if everything was over, Jesus would recognize him. They let him down. Here he is, right down there at Jesus' feet. What's Jesus going to do? Now, he knows the power of the Lord is present to heal.
Yeah.
So he looks at this man and he says, thy sins are forgiven thee. Which I think meant a lot to that man.
Mm-hmm.
The indication are that this is probably something like that man in the pool of Bethesda.
Mm.
Jesus said, sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. That the condition may have been caused by iniquity. It says, thy sins be forgiven. See, it already been done.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say your sins can be forgiven you.
That's right.
Your sins ought to be forgiven you. Your sins will be forgiven you. He says they are. They are.
Amen.
They are forgiven you. Now this is before Jesus took away the sins of the world.
Mm-hmm.
This is before he made an end to sin,
mm-hmm,
brought in everlasting righteousness. This is the same thing he said to the woman who anointed his feet. You remember? He said it's the same words to her. Thy sins are forgiven. She said the same thing to her. Jesus had the power on earth,
mm-hmm,
much more now in heaven. But
yeah, yeah.
He had the power to do that. He had the authority to do that. See, this was a word of authority. Jesus wasn't dependent on something else happening.
That's right. Uh-huh.
He had this power,
amen,
to do this. But this wasn't how it was always going to be done.
Mm-hmm.
This is for this occasion. Well, the scribes, the Pharisees and the doctors of the law, they're here. They hear this. See, they were listening. What's going on? They were listening. They began to reason. I'm assuming this was inside, not outside, inside themselves. Who is this that speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God? Notice how here was a tremendous blessing that occurred. and they find some fault with it. They were so steeped in Jewish tradition, they didn't know how to apply the scripture. God said that he forgives iniquity. He told Moses, I forgive iniquity. He told him that. So there's to be no question about can someone in the name of Jesus. See, the question was whether or not Jesus was qualified to say this, and they didn't think he was. They thought he was blaspheming. Now, it's important to remember that the destiny of every person hinges on what Jesus is going to say about him. When everybody stands before the judgment seat of Christ, what Jesus says about every person is going to determine their eternal destiny. Now that in this day of salvation, now is the time to get things right between you and God, to be reconciled to God. This is the time to get that done. It'd be too late then. Jesus, he knows, he knew what was in their hearts, though. He knew it. He said, why are you thinking like this? Why are you reasoning like this? Sometimes I've got quiet enough, I could hear Jesus saying that to me. What are you thinking that way for? Why are you thinking like that? Except he said this verbally to these to these people. They did not believe Jesus could forgive sin. Why? Because they're carnally minded. Mm-hmm. The carnal mind can't comprehend this.
Right.
See, their thoughts were not God's thoughts. Remember when God said, these are my thoughts and not your thoughts, my ways are not your ways. See, God still feels the same about people whose ways and thoughts clash with his ways and thoughts. God still feels that way. Then he poses the question to him. He says, which is easier? Is it easier to say, thy sins be forgiven thee, or is it easier to say, rise up and walk? And invariably the flesh will say, well, of course it's easier to say your sins be forgiven you, because you can't see there. Yeah. It's harder to say, pick up your bed and walk. You're doing something there, see? Yeah. But they were wrong.
Yeah.
It's actually harder, speaking as a man, it's harder to say your sins are forgiven than it is to take up your bed and walk.
Yeah.
But they knew they didn't know that. So that you will know that I have power on earth to forgive sins. Just so you'll know.
Yeah.
All of you know this man's a paralytic. All of you know he's laying on a bed. All of you know he couldn't do anything by himself. Yeah. All of you know 4 men had to let him down here. You can tell by looking at him, this man can't walk.
Mm-hmm.
The real point I want you to see is that I can forgive sin.
Yeah.
So you can see that, he says, just stand up and walk.
Yeah.
Pick up your bed, stand up, walk, and go home.
Yeah.
Arise. He creates the situation by his words, see?
Yeah.
Take up your couch or your bed. Pick it up. The thing you've been laying on, the thing that's been having hold of you, the thing that conquered you, pick it up.
Yeah.
Pick it up. And go to your house. Now, unless his physical traits had been noticeably altered, which I can see arguments both ways, that when he was made straight as he looked healthy, I could understand that, but I could also understand how he might not have looked healthy. I do not doubt that, like the woman that had the issue of blood, it says she felt in her body that she was healed. I think this man felt in his body. I think that's how he was able to just rise up. Felt in his body. See, there's a certain confidence that accompanies faith.
Yes, amen.
There comes a time as you grow up into Christ, you change from glory into glory, you get to the stage, I can do it stage. You actually get to that point. I can get up. Now I can get up.
Yeah.
And I can walk where I had a lot of difficulty doing it. It's like, I can do it now.
Mm-hmm.
Faith will convince you of that. Immediately he arose. Before them. Jesus didn't say, just a minute, we're going to take him in the back room like Oral Roberts did. We'll take him in the back room. And nobody will really know whether anything happened or not. We'll take him. That's not what Jesus did.
That's right.
Jesus said, get up right here. Everyone's looking at you. Get up. While they're looking at you, get up.
Yeah.
While they're looking at you, pick up your bed and get out of here as fast as you can. And then he looks at the man and said, that you may know that the Son of Man, that's it. That you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. The Son of Man. I wanted to say a few words about that, the Son of Man. Jesus refers to himself most frequently by that phrase, the Son of Man. When John was on the Isle of Patmos, saw the glorified Christ, he says he's turned and saw one like unto the Son of Man. It's Jesus' manhood that enables us to comprehend him.
Yeah, that's right.
See? That's the thing that makes him spiritually visible to us. The fact that he's like us, see?
Yeah.
He has a shape and a form. God doesn't have a form or a shape. Man Christ Jesus. He makes him discernible, see? His humanity is what makes him discernible.
Yeah.
Not the fact that he's one of the boys. Not that kind of humanity. He's unique among men. He's a man that's unique among men. He stands out among men. And that condition causes you to be able to see him as he is. See, Christ in the nature of God is not clear to those in the world. You can't make it out. But as a man, he can. He's a chief man. It's a chief man. He's the perfect depiction of what man is intended to be.
Yeah, amen.
Arise, he creates you. Immediately he goes to his own house. They were amazed. Hey, how about that? Some versions say they were, amazement seized all of them. They were nonplussed. It just took their breath away. Oh, never seen anything like that. Maybe you thought, I wish I could see something like that. I once testified that I've never gone to hear a famous preacher where I wasn't disappointed. That goes for all famous preachers that I've heard. And I've heard quite a few. But they weren't quite what I expected. You've heard a lot of preachers, Gene. Have you experienced that kind of thing? You hear someone that has a reputation of being good, but when you hear them, it's good, but I mean, left a little room there. Yeah. But when you hear Jesus, you're amazed.
Amen.
Confounded. I imagine there were people there that had been reasoning like Gideon reasoned. Where be all his miracles which our fathers told us of?
Yeah.
See, so here Gideon and many years have raised up hearing testimonies about these tremendous works and miracles in the past, but nothing like that's happening here. So Gideon says, where? Maybe you've thought that. I read in the book of Acts, and boy, it thrills your soul, but then you try and find a parallel here in the world, you see. It's not there. So they were amazed. And they glorified God, which means there was no one else could get the glory but God. They couldn't give credit to anybody but God. And they were filled with fear. Fear of the unknown. There's something about seeing something that's outside the domain of human experience that is frightening. You see a figure, you've never seen anything like that before. It awakens fear. You were filled with fear. And the word translated fear means alarm, fright, or terror. Scared. That is what it means. Not because it was scary, what they saw was scary. It was by comparison, there wasn't anything like this. And whenever you get outside the domain of human experience, it does get scary. If you don't have faith, it gets scary. They said, we've seen strange things today.
Yeah.
Some versions say, we've seen remarkable things today. We've seen unimaginable things, extraordinary things. I must admit, I want to be able to say this more and more and more. Say, well, we've seen some great things today, haven't we? And not necessarily strange, but bountiful. And see, God is greatly to be feared, the psalmist said, in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence among all that are about him. He is to be feared, Psalm 76:7 says. And if ever anybody, could be Moses, could be Isaiah, could be Elijah, could be Daniel, whoever's been in the presence of God has feared. That's what he does. Thankfully, the fear is mixed with praise and faith and thanksgiving. It's not just fear alone. Well, those are some of the things that in a typical day of the Lord, this was a kind of, we got a little slice of what his life was like. Marvelous, wasn't it?
Yes, amen.
And it should teach us that it's never never vain to seek the Lord.
That's right.
You can come to him like the Pharisees and doctors of the law. You can come that way and end up seeing things that you disagree with, or you can come like those four men bringing it. Palsied man.
Yeah.
That's what to do with your friends. That's what to do.
Amen.
Bring them to Christ.
Amen.
Yes.
You know, it says that he looked on their faith.
Yeah, their faith. That's right.
You know, and that, you just said this, when you bring in your friends or your, how about some of your relatives? Some of your,
that's it.
You depend that God's going to honor your request because of your faith.
Because of your faith. That's
you
right.
You believe that he can do it.
That's right. Yeah. Yes, Brother Aaron.
The gospel is the record of Jesus Christ, but kind of a side benefit is a record of human nature as well.
That's right.
Because we see the reaction, whether good or bad, to what Jesus said and what Jesus did. It's like we have a conflict of natures between the divine and the human. And this really is still going on today.
Amen.
Because Jesus hasn't changed, and he's still working, and human nature hasn't changed either. So it's always been, well, maybe I shouldn't say always, but it kind of bothers me how that commonly the gospel record is viewed as kind of the Holy Grail.
That's right.
Kind of a
museum,
the golden
piece.
Age that has passed. It's good to read, but I really wish we could have been there, and that kind of thing. Well, the fact is, Jesus hasn't changed, and human nature hasn't changed either.
That's right.
Our need hasn't changed, so there really isn't as much difference between the gospel record and today as is commonly supposed.
Amen. Good.
Amen.
Yes, Brother Jesus.
I want to check this word strange. Source, it comes from the Greek word where we get the word paradox.
It clashed with what was normal.
There's some in the account that did not expect this, but there were some in the account that did.
Didn't expect
the leper expected it.
He expected it.
The
amen.
Four men who brought the friend, they expected that.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
So they saw wondrous things. The ones who expected it saw wondrous things. They saw what they expected.
Yeah. Amen.
And the others saw unexpected.
Unexpected things.
And heard unexpected things. That's we want to be in the group that saw the things they expected.
This is that.
Yeah. We don't want to be in the group that saw things they didn't expect.
Yeah, that's right.
I like that word paradox. What they were used to, they didn't see what they were used to seeing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, even the believers didn't see what they were used to seeing.
Yeah.
But they believed they would see it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They were familiar with what God said he would do. Yeah.
If you are willing, you can make me clean.
Mm.
Right.
But Jason?
What's that? Well, I thought you had your hand up. I was putting you out.
Oh, I did, yeah. 5-4?
Yeah.
Okay. I was just going to point out there that this whole miracle was done as an illustration of Christ's authority.
Mm.
But he said authority on earth If this is authoritative, you should see him now.
Amen.
Yeah. His authority has been compounded by his ascension into heaven, which is what is, you know, the term Son of Man comes from Daniel 7.
Yes, amen.
Which is a prophetic picture of Christ going back into heaven, where he has received literally all authority in heaven and on earth. That's what Jesus said before he ascended. He said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. The
scene that we see in Revelation 5 demonstrates that. He took the scroll.
That's right.
And opened the seals.
That's right.
Because he had authority to do that.
Yeah.
See, there's more involved in divine authority than the earth. There's a vast cosmopolitan of personalities, both good and evil. He's over everything. Yes, Brother Aaron.
All of Jesus' miracles had salvation stamp all over.
Yes, amen. Yes.
There's no gospel, no miracle that is unrelated or disconnected to the work that God gave him to do. I like that for several reasons. One is that the miracles kind of fleshed out the unseen.
That's good.
So we can,
that's
it
good.
Gives us a another index into the eternal.
Amen. Mm-hmm. All right, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this record. We thank you for the greatness of the Lord Jesus, that even his life on earth was unique and distinctive. Now that he's been exalted above all things, help us to widen our perspective about what is to be done and what's available, to learn from these examples that Jesus is approachable and that there are things he wants to do for us. Grant us to conform our thinking to this. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Mm-hmm.